Oh, glory to God. Glory to God, glory to God. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Hallelujah. Make us bold, Lord. Make us bold. Call us to be bold. Hallelujah. 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 My Lord. My God. This Wednesday, this Friday, I was on the radio. I got off the radio. And, Papa and I came in and we were taking these speakers down on the corner. And this lady rushed in the door. And I thought she was coming for prayer, noonday prayer. She had a Bible in her hand and she said, had never seen her before. And she said, I'm looking for the pastor. And I said, oh, I'm the pastor. I said, you coming for prayer today? And she said, no. She said, I need to talk to you. And I could tell just by her demeanor that she was, that something was wrong. And I could tell that there was something spiritually wrong. We got back to my office and she sat down and she began to talk to me about the years that she had, the number of years that she had been attacked, tormented by demonic spirits. And she was so under attack. Mind was so under attack. She thought her house was attacked. She thought the house that she had left prior to the one she just bought was demon possessed. And I said, no, I said, the demons are just tormenting you. And I just tried to get to the root of it, where it started. And she had a wreck in 1969 that killed her only child. Killed her sister and her sister's only child. Critically injured her mother. And she survived, and her mom survived. Her mom later passed, but she said between 69 and 72, she had a lot to get over. And she would just always proclaim that she was victorious and that she was more than a conqueror. And she just felt so empowered. But in 72, she started feeling like she was just under attack. Her mind was under attack. She began to see things and hear things. And she said she's gone all over the place to talk to preachers and teachers and so on and so forth, and everybody thought she's crazy. Well, I could tell she wasn't crazy. I could tell she was just tormented. You get tormented long enough, you'll sound like somebody crazy. And if you talk to somebody that does not understand spiritual warfare, they'll make you think you're crazy. But I knew she wasn't crazy. I knew this sister was just under a spiritual attack. And she knew her Bible. She knew a Bible real good. I could quote a scripture, and she could say it right along with me without even going to it in her Bible. So I knew she knew her Bible. I knew she knew the Word. And she would open her Word, and she said, I've been reading these scriptures, and I've been reading these passages, and it just seems like it's not working. And I said, well, that one thing for sure, the Word works. So you'll never have to look at the Word to determine if the Word of God works. It works. It has power. And so we kept talking and talking. And I kept going through the Word of God. I kept reading the Word of God to her. And I realized, she helped me to realize that she knew the Word on these pages from reading them. But those words were not owned by her. She didn't own those words. She didn't speak them like she owned them. She didn't speak them like they were true. She wasn't, you know, if God says something, she didn't take it and say that if God said it, this is true. If he says I'm more than a conqueror, I'm more than a conqueror. She just knew that she was more than a conqueror. But she didn't make herself more than a conqueror by reading the word of God. So the word was only a logos word to her. Word written on pages. It hadn't become alive in her. It hadn't become something that she owned. And I began to talk to her, and God had me remember what she first said in between 69 and 72, how she would proclaim and how she would speak over her life and how she would say, you know, people thought she was going to fall apart because she had lost her child and lost her sister and lost her nephew. And her mama was critically ill. And she said she just kept speaking the word of God and proclaiming the word of God. And she said, I tell you, I had so much power. And something happened. She got spooked in 72 and she just stopped speaking. As long as she was speaking,
amen,
she was victorious.
Amen.
As long as that word that was on those pages, as long as she was speaking that word, she had victory. She said she was speaking that word sometime without even having faith in it. And after speaking it so long, her faith built up in that particular word that she was speaking from her mouth. That woman walked in, demon-possessed, and walked out delivered. Walked out here delivered. I'm telling you, she walked out of here. She walked out of here. She walked out of here delivered. Because she realized the tormenting was only taking place in her mind. See, it's easy to be delivered when you understand the word. It's easy to be delivered when you receive the word. Because the devil has no power. The devil has no authority. The devil can't do anything to hurt you. Can't do anything to harm you. You understand? So as long as the devil can't do those things to hurt you or to harm you, he has no power over you. And so this woman realized he has no power. He has no power. He has no power over me because Jesus has given me all the power. Jesus has given me all the authority. You follow what I'm saying? He's given me all the power, all the authority. Y'all can't hear me in the live stream? Amen. He's given me all the power. He's given me all the authority. And as long as he is giving you all the power and all the authority, as long as you have all the, as long as you have, you know you have all the power and all the authority. See, child of God, it don't work unless you know it.
Amen.
I tell you what, I wish I was talking to somebody this morning. It don't work unless you know it. Hallelujah. Doesn't work unless you know who you are. Praise God. This woman walked in not knowing who she was. She walked in. She knew the word. A lot of us know the word. But that word, the word of God is real. She said, the reason I came, because the way you speak on the radio, you speak so boldly on the radio. And she said, you even bolder sitting in front of me. You speak. I said, that word, I believe that word. That word, if God said, I believe that word. If God said it, I believe it. If he said the word, if he spoke it, I believe it. If God said I'm more than a conqueror, I believe I'm more than a conqueror. Amen. I don't come to church to be convinced about anything. I'm already convinced. I'm already convinced. I'm already convinced that Jesus Christ is real. I'm already convinced that Jesus Christ died for my sins. I'm already convinced that Jesus' death on Calvary Cross caused me to be the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I'm already convinced of that. I'm already convinced that I'm right with God. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm already convinced that when I lay hands on sick, that they shall recover. Amen. I expected that woman, when I found out what was going on with her, I expected her to be delivered in the name of Jesus. I didn't know how soon God was going to do it, but I expected him to deliver her in the name of Jesus. Because James said, if there's any sick or disease among you, to call on the elders of the church. That's what that woman did. She got in her car. She drove from Greenwood, Louisiana, and she come here, amen, because she was seeking God. She was seeking help. Amen. And God is looking for helpers. He's looking for people that will help him. Amen. God needs somebody that will go out and help. Just like them fellows, amen, took their friend on that couch and lowered him through that roof. They were helping Jesus.
They were helping God. And God is looking for helpers. He's looking for us to be helpers. Amen. He's looking for us to be helpers. And we got to be helpers. We got to be bold. See, the world is bold. The world is bold. I tell you, the world is so bold. And they got us quiet. They're so bold, we got them quiet. We only talk to one another. We only talk to the believers because the world's gotten so bold and we just quiet. They're bold in their music. They're bold in their behavior. And I tell you what, and what's happening is they're winning folks that we're supposed to be winning. And the only reason they're winning is because we are so quiet. We're so quiet. We've caused church to be an institution. We've caused it to be a membership. And not us being the body of Christ going out to win the lost. God says we got to be bold. Amen. We got to be bold. We got to be loud. We got to be heard. People got to know that you're a believer. They got to know that you're a Christian. They got to know that you believe Jesus. They got to know that you believe in prayer. They got to know that you believe in going to church. Amen. Lifting your hands, praising God, worshiping God. Amen. People ought to know that about you. They don't know anything else about you. They ought to know that's a child of God right over there. Amen. We have got to shake ourselves. No matter if you're introverted or extroverted, you have got to become a child of God that's bold. Hallelujah. Bold in our jobs. Bold in our homes. Everywhere we go, we got to be bold. Amen. We got to walk in with authority. Walk in with the confidence. Amen. Because we know who we are. We know whose we are. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Quick to lift our hands. Quick to praise God. Quick to pray for somebody who's sick. Glory, hallelujah. I'm telling you, you got to get rid of all this stuff you got going on in your life that's got you bound. Jesus said, in this world, you will have tribulations. And you can't let them tribulations keep you in bondage. Hold you down. Because as soon as God delivers you from one, the devil will hand you another one. How to keep on moving and trucking on through it. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Gotta learn how to keep on going. Right. The only thing that matters is Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. You praise God for a second after that victory, and before you know it, something else is coming around the corner. In this world, you're gonna have tribulation, you're gonna have trials. But you ought to have a mind to serve God and to worship God and to praise God and to lift God up no matter what. You wake up in the morning, your electricity off. Praise God! I'm still praising God. He ain't going to shut my prayer off. It's not going to shut me off from thanking Him and worshiping Him and lifting Him up. People treat you wrong, still praise God. Up, stop giving up and stop letting up and slowing up. God needs helpers. Hallelujah. We decreed here on Thursday night that the devil cannot have Shreveport, Louisiana. He can't have Shreveport, Louisiana. We came in Thursday night and we prayed in here. My God, the place was packed. Thank God for all of you who came and worked and helped. But I tell you what, the Spirit of the Lord just went up. Amen. I prayed that day. I said, Lord, don't let it rain. So we'd be able to do this on the outside. And the rain came. And as I was praying and asking God not to let it rain while sitting in my car out here in the parking lot, the rain started coming down. And the devil said, you asked him not to let it rain, and he let it rain. And I said, oh, Mr. Devil, he's God. If he let it rain, he knew that something needed to be watered. Who am I to be selfish here on the corner of Roberts and Hollywood want him to stop it from raining just for our little old event. If he allowed it to rain, he allowed it to rain for a reason. He's God. We walked out of here after prayer and walked outside and seen that pretty rainbow. Did y'all see that rainbow? Y'all see that rainbow? God said to me, I'll let it rain so that after your prayer service, you would know that I've got the city of Shreveport covered. Hallelujah. I tell you what, this is a beautiful rainbow with all the colors in it. And you can see it from, you know, some rainbows you can see it start, but you can't see it in. But you can see the complete rainbow. How many of you saw that? Hallelujah. Well, you know what? God put that rainbow up there for us. It was a sign from the Lord that he heard our prayer and that he's covering this city. Hallelujah. That he's pleased with abounding grace. He was pleased with the prayers that went up. Hallelujah. But child of God, it's time for us to be bold. You won't do it unless you stop worrying about yourself and worrying about your stuff. Worrying about what you're going through. Keep praying for that. But let me tell you something. A lot of times those things don't come because that's where they become your God. They become the things that you give more attention to. Whatever you're giving the most attention to is your God. That's what you're worshiping. I tell you, God needs you. God needs you to be a helper. He needs you to be a mouthpiece. He needs you to open up. He needs you to have a bold mouth. Say a bold mouth.
Bold mouth.
Say it three times. Bold mouth. That's what he needs you to do, is open your mouth and speak. Hallelujah. Don't worry about the person next to you. They may not do it. You do it. You say something. You lay hands. Hallelujah. Somebody come around you sick, you lay hands on them. In the name of Jesus, be healed. Be bold. Be bold. The book of Acts, 4th chapter, verse 29. It says, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servant that with all boldness they may speak thy word, by stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child, Jesus. And when they had prayed, say when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Amen. They prayed for boldness. After they had prayed, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they were filled with boldness. Our God gives us what we need. Amen. Amen. If you ask God for boldness, God will give you boldness. Say, Lord, give me boldness. Say, Lord, give me boldness to speak. Amen. Now, mean it when you say, Lord, give me boldness to speak. I tell you what, if God knows that you will speak, then people will come to you to hear something. If God knows that you will speak, that you're just ready and waiting for an opportunity, then the Holy Ghost will lead you always to a place where somebody needs to hear the word of God. Amen. The Holy Spirit will always provide and create a place and somebody that's in need, and the Holy Spirit will line you up for that person, and you'll always be in a position where you'll be able to speak to that person. Because God say, that person will, you'll speak for me. So because you'll speak for me, I'm going to put somebody from the harvest that needs you. I'm going to send this laborer to this place where they can speak on my behalf. Amen. Amen. But if God knows that you will never open your mouth, that you'll be quiet, that you're too busy about what's going on in your life, your family life, that you're still trying to gain, you will never ever get to the point where you're not trying to gain something. You will never get to the place where you got everything you need You may have everything material you need, but your body may start breaking down. So you'll never get to the place where you can say, oh, I got all the help I need, all the money I need, but the right job and everything is just lining up. No, you got to learn how to worship God, serve God in the midst of your storm. In the midst of needing something, you got to say, I'm still going to worship God. Wake up in the morning with a headache and don't come to church. Come to church and get healed of that headache. Because you go to work. You go to work. But I'll tell you what, when you say, what I'm doing is for God. I'm serving God. And you'll see the hand of God move and you become bold. You become so bold, you tell that headache, leave headache in the name of Jesus. My wife got up this morning. She walked around. She had a little catch or something in her hip. Amen. She went to bed with it. Amen. She walked around, and I was so pleased. She came around. She said, Brian, pray. Pray for my hip. I said, praise God. So God has sent people to you. Now, she my wife. He has sent people to you when he know you will pray. We prayed for that hip. She walked out the room. She said, now, go on. You go on a walk, and you know that you healed in Jesus' name. Don't be looking to be healed. You heal when we call the name of Jesus. She walked on out of there, walked back in. She said, it's gone. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that all of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. See, when we begin to put our minds on the things of God, we gonna take our minds off of these little old material things that's gonna fade away. All the stuff that you gaining and you hoarding up, amen, that you think's gonna be around forever, amen, that you adding value to, that stuff don't have no value to it. Huh. Store up for your children. Leave your children good in good shape where they don't have to, when you die, they don't have all your bills. But, take care of your business. Do that stuff. But only put your trust and your faith and your hope in the things that are eternal. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah.
Amen. That's right.
That house ain't eternal. That car ain't eternal. You pull off the lock, it's depreciated. Right there. Amen. These bodies, amen. You can fix these bodies up all you want to. But I'm telling you what, these bodies are not eternal that we have right now. But there is a body that he has for us that is eternal. Amen. All we got is Jesus. All we got is to speak the word of God. All we got is to teach Jesus. Teach Jesus everywhere we go. Be bold everywhere we go. Hallelujah. It's time to get noisy for Jesus. Amen. Amen. At your house, on your job, wherever you at in school, wherever you at, it's time to be bold for Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. It says, and with great power gave the apostles witnesses of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. See, when they began to pray, God gave them boldness. And when boldness came, all the people got together and had one mind and one heart. They weren't concerned about their stuff, amen. They weren't concerned about any of those things, amen. They just was concerned about doing what God had called them to do, amen. And they began to take their stuff and share it so that everybody would have something. So that everybody was equal, amen, because they understood that those things were temporal. They were temporal. They were going to come and go, amen. You understand? That stuff going to go, man. I'm telling you, I've done a lot of funerals, and not one time have any Wells Fargo truck or a furniture truck or a car, amen, you may been carried to the funeral home with somebody.
Yeah.
Or to the burial ground. Amen. Heard this story about where this man said, that he wanted, wrote in his will that when he died, he wanted $50,000 placed in his casket of his money. or no, 50% placed in his casket of his money. The other 50% he was leaving for his wife. And she told the funeral home, she said, that's what he wanted. That's what we'll do. You want 50%? We'll put 50% of his money, he was very wealthy, in his casket. And the funeral home director said, are you sure you want to do that? And she said, I'm sure. He said, do we need an armored car, a protection, police protection? She said, no, I don't think we'll need any of that because I'm just going to write a check. Put it in there. And if he's able to get up and cash it, he'll be all right. Amen. I don't think he'll cash it. Amen. Because in his life, whatever you leave in his life is left. Only what you do for Christ will last. Only what you do for Christ is going to last. And so we got to be bold. We got to be bold. You know, now this story, I started on verse 29, and it's talking about Paul, talking about Peter and John, amen, when they were preaching and teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, and when they were beaten for it, and when they were locked up for it. And here's the first part of it, you know, we'll go up a little bit before this. You remember Jesus had been crucified, and now Peter and John are out being bold, doing the word of God. It says, then on the following day, their magistrate and elders and scribes were assembled in Jerusalem, including Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and all the others who belonged to the high priestly relationship. See, all the head people were there. All the big people were there, okay? And they set the men in their midst, set these disciples in their midst, and repeatedly demanded by what sort of power. Said, by what power? Because they had lifted this man prior to this man that was lame. You know, they said, sit and go have our none, rise up and walk. They exercised that power. See, these rulers thought, man, this was over with when they had gotten rid of Jesus. When they crucified Jesus, they thought, hey, all that stuff we saw Jesus do and people said he did, the miracles, it's over because now Jesus is dead. But all of a sudden, some of Jesus' disciples, amen, are doing the same thing that Jesus was doing. And they want to know now, by what power or by what kind of authority did such people as you do this? Healing. Say, you ain't nothing but a fisherman. Uneducated individual. By what power or what authority were you able to do this? By what kind of authority did you have? Or what power did you have? That caused, see, they know that this man was lame. They know that he was unable to walk. And all of a sudden, he's up and walking. And Peter and John were responsible for it. And this was a then Peter, because he was filled with and controlled by the Holy Spirit. How many of you want to be filled and controlled by the Holy Ghost? Hallelujah. You know, if you want to be filled and controlled by the Holy Ghost, you can't be filled and controlled by happy hour.
Come on now.
You can't be filled and controlled by fornication and adultery. Amen. And greed. And jealousy and all those things. You cannot be filled with the Holy Ghost and have all of this lifestyle that you're living that is contrary to holiness. Yeah. Amen. And I'm going to tell you something. A lot of times we can't lift our hands and raise our voice and talk to other people because we're living like the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
I ain't talking to unbelievers. I'm talking to believers.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
And so Peter and John, They could stand flat footed in front of the rulers and they can speak boldly to them.
Yeah.
Because their only assignment and mission was to live for God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Then Peter, he was filled with the control by the Spirit, said to them rulers of the people and members of the council of the Sanhedrin, if we are being put on trial here today and examined concerning a good deed done to benefit a feeble, helpless cripple, by what means this man has been restored to health, let it be known. So let it be known. Let it be known. We ought to go places and let it be known.
Amen.
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 We ought to go places and let it be known. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let it be known and understood by all of you and by the whole house of Israel that in the name and in the name and through the power and authority of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, in him and by him and by means of him, this man is standing here before you well and sound in body. Glory, hallelujah. I tell you, that is good for you and good for me, because they're talking about Jesus Christ after the resurrection, and we are children of God after the resurrection.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So if you want to know what happened, if you want to know about what power this happened, if you want to understand about what authority this happened, it is by the authority of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Let's not get it twisted. They mentioned where Jesus was from, so they wouldn't have any questions.
Right.
I'm Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh, that's the one we crucified. It is by him and his resurrection that we were able to cause this man to stand in death. It is nothing based on me. It's nothing based on the other disciple. It is simply based on Jesus Christ, whom we believe.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Bold. And this Jesus is the stone which was despised and rejected by you, the builder, but which has become the head of the corner, the cornerstone. And there is salvation in and through no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by and in which we must be saved.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There's no other name.
That's right.
There's no other name. There's no other name. I tell you, child of God, we got to become bold and let people know there's no other name. We're too quiet. We've been too quiet. And the devil has got hordes of demons. I'm telling you, there are hordes of demons.
Yeah.
Hordes of demons. And there's so many demons now that we're seeing in our world, seeing in our city. It's so many demons. It's so many demons. So many demons. Demons of murder. Demons that are killing people. Demons that are doing all these things that we never dreamed that we would witness or hear. Demons possessing people. Demons killing people. People laying with people. Like it's nothing. It's nothing.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
People are not even, you know, they're not even worried about it like they used to be.
Amen.
Gays and lesbians, amen, used to be in the closet when I came up. Ain't no more closets.
Amen.
People knew it was wrong and they kind of hid. But now nobody's hiding. The world has gotten to be very vocal in their music, rap music, their music talking about, you know, I tell you what, they did a poll to find out what was common among a certain age group of African American men that were in prison for first degree murder. Or manslaughter or whatever. And they tried to find out what was common among them. Did they eat the same breakfast that morning? Did they drink the same drink? Were they all intoxicated? Were their blood level of drugs the same? This and that. There was one common thing that was among the percentage of them, and that was prior to them pulling the trigger, they were all listening or had been listening to some rap music. That was hyping them up. That was encouraging them. What you hear encourages you. What you spend time listening to encourages you. If you're listening to the wrong stuff, it will encourage you and influence you the wrong way. And the devil has gotten so busy by infiltrating the music. Man, I tell you what, he's in the music. Your children listening to that rap stuff, and my young people in here, don't listen to that stuff. I'll tell you, that stuff is, it's, you don't think it's planting seeds, it's planting seeds in your mind. I tell you what, we used to, people my age would be offended and mad and ready to fight when people used the N-word back in the day. But we have devalued ourselves so that we use it like a person's name. And you know what we as the Christians have said about it? Nothing. Know what we've done about it? Nothing. Because we're not bold. The other folk are bold. They run and shot on everything. They bold and they looking strong and they looking powerful. And we're not bold. We just be quiet. We pray in secret, you know. Tell you what, God wants to be bold. He's calling us to be bold. When Peter was praying, he was praying for boldness. Boldness. And the Bible said he was led by the Holy Spirit. See, when you're bold, the Holy Spirit will lead you. I don't want to be bold on my own because I'll say the wrong thing. I'll do the wrong thing. But when I pray and ask God to fill me with his Spirit or the Spirit's up on me and I pray for boldness, I tell you what, it's going to take being bold. It's going to take being a bold believer to turn things around. It's going to take being bold in this nation to turn things around. It's going to take being bold in this city to turn things around. Listen, we all leave here. We all go different places. And wherever you're going, you can be bold for the Lord. If you're going home, you can be bold. If you're going to your job, you can be bold. If you're with a group of friends who are talking crazy, you ought to be bold right there in that second. Let me tell you, I'm a child of God. I don't talk that way any longer. Amen. But I say you gotta let go. You gotta be. I tell you what, you can't be an 80 Christian or a 90 Christian. You gotta be a 2016 Christian. Amen. In 80 and 90, we say, okay, I got 1 foot, you know, at the church and 1 foot wherever else I want. Yeah. No, we can't live that way any longer. During that time, the devil has released hordes of demons. Hordes of demons. Hordes of there's a lot of demons, amen, that's in the area. We don't have anything to fear because we have the power. I said, we got the power. Amen. Ephesians, I'm in Ephesians, amen, real quick, 6, it says, "Finally, brother, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." That's the strategies of the devil. Look at yourself. Look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor. Point at your neighbor. See, you better understand the devil got strategies against you. He's got strategies against you. He's got strategies against your children. He's got strategies against the health of your body. He's got strategies against your business. That's all wiles of strategies. He's got strategies against you. His objective, child of God, is to take you down and to take you out. That's the wiles of the devil. The devil's plan is to destroy you. You got goals. You got plans. His objective is to make sure you don't reach it. His plan is to make sure you never reach your destination. Amen. And if you're moving and moseying on towards your destination without praying and without calling on the name of the Lord, without trusting in God, you are surely not making it. Because his objective is to make sure that you don't make it. Make sure your children, amen, are destroyed. He steal, kill, and destroy. He steal, kill, and destroy. He's doing it every single day. And nobody is immune to it. No one is immune to his attack. The only thing that causes a wall to be around you is you putting on the whole armor of God. Amen. Hallelujah. You can't send them to a good enough school. Ain't no good schools you can send them to. ain't no good neighborhoods. Let them make the fence a mile high. The devil's still coming in. Long as you got people living in there, you got the devil living in the people. Jesus had Judas at his table. You think we're not going to have somebody at ours? Amen. It says the wiles of the devil, the strategies of the devil. You got to look at every area of your life and try to identify where can he come in. You ain't doing it out of fear. You're not doing it out of fear. You're doing it because you're setting up. You're putting the armor of God on. You got to know what areas to pray. Where to target your prayers. Pray for your wife. Pray for your children. Pray for your home. Pray for your job. Pray for the health of your body. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, you get to pray. The Holy Spirit will put stuff on your mind that you didn't even think to pray about. Because the Holy Spirit knows the devil knocking at the door right there. You better pray for it. Hallelujah. So we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Let me read that again. We wrestle not. Yo, listen, I don't care how emotional you are, I don't care how bad you've been hurt and how wrong somebody's doing you or have done you. That ain't who your fight is with. Your fight is with the devil. And the devil is so happy that you haven't realized it yet. Because the only way you can get him off is through prayer. And sometimes we get so mad at the person that's doing it, we know it's the devil that's causing them to do it, but we still don't pull away and pray.
Amen. Come on.
Amen.
You read that Bible, it's going to tell you it's the devil. It tells you in Ephesians 4:27, neither give room to the devil. It tells us to be vigilant, to be watchful. Because our adversary is as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. The Lord gives us all kind of clues and hints. The devil is after you.
Amen.
To destroy you, to destroy your mind.
Yeah.
And you sit back and you are all cool and you think you don't want to be embarrassed. You don't want people to know what's going on in your life and your family. And eventually the devil's objective is that everybody will know.
Amen.
So you can keep quiet all you want to. Because at the appointed time, he's going to expose what's going on.
Amen.
And the only reason he didn't expose it now is because he wanted to get nasty for you before he exposed it. That's right. Is that Sister Pam preaching over there? Come on.
Amen.
Got a trap set for you. It's a trap. That's exactly what it is. And it's going to get you. It's gonna get you. If you ain't mind, if you don't know where the dark's coming from, you looking crazy at somebody, not speaking to somebody, you think, oh, they no, listen, the devil is your enemy. I don't care who he's in habit to cause them to act funny with you, it is the devil that's done it.
Amen.
It says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God. That he says, take unto you the whole armor of God. Child of God, you can sing all you want to. That ain't putting no armor on you.
That's right.
You can carry your Bible in your truck, put all kind of crosses around your neck. That is not, you know, this the devil, you ain't warning the devil off. You can't do this, you know, and he's not going to come. It says, put on the whole armor, take unto you the whole armor of God that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. Not days, but evil day. Because God never expected us not to put on the armor.
Come on.
So God ain't said, let this thing pile up on you and put the armor on so you can defend the days. He said, day, every day is the only day you have.
Yeah.
And every day you ought to have an armor on so you can fight for your marriage.
Amen.
Oh, my marriage in good shape. Well, I tell you what, That's what makes the devil want to destroy, is in good shape. My children are fine, okay. He's dependent on you not to pray for your children because they fine. He's dependent on you not to do, pray over your body because you exercise and you healthy. And people tell you, you look good. Girl, you look like you're 20 years old. And you know you're not 20. But you think, well, because people saying that, you ain't got to go, you ain't got to pray and ask God to help my body. Help my body, God, help me. You don't feel 20, and you might look 20, but you don't feel 20. And you think, because somebody giving you compliments, it's all the devil. His objective is to cause you not to be sensitive to his presence. He's crafty. And he wants to destroy you. Amen. Just hang on to you the whole arm of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. I'll tell you what, there's evil days in our city. And we're taking our city back. We've already started. Taking our families back. We've already started. Amen. Praise God. Families praying together. Families covering each other. Whether your children are at home or not, you got to pray over your children. Pray over your family, amen. I'm telling you, you got to pray. They may not have told you everything that's going on in their life. You pray, 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 pray. Pray over your grandchildren. Pray that nobody touched them the wrong way. Pray over them in the name of Jesus. Pray over your spouse, amen. Hallelujah. People kidnapping folks and doing all kinds of things. Amen. Pray, pray, pray. Pray over your neighbor's housing, your neighbor's children. Glory, hallelujah. Pray. That's what families do. Pray. And then what you do, you pray after that. You keep on praying. Driving your car. Turn that radio off. Pray, pray, pray. Get back in your car, pray. My car is my temple. It's the place where I go and pray. I tell you, you can drive and pray. Turn that radio off. Turn that cell phone off. Pray. Pray. Because that devil, I'm telling you, that's in these hordes of demons. That's a sign to do nothing but destroy you. Come after you. Can catch you depressed. Catch you discouraged. Catch you disappointed. Catch you in doubt. They can't come until those doors are open for them. And as soon as depression comes, that opens a door for the spirit to come in. He can't come without you first being depressed. Because depression, disappointment, discouragement all represents the absence of God's presence. And wherever there's an absence of God's presence, evil is there. And wherever evil is, the devil is there. So the devil, he ain't everywhere because he's not all present and all that. He has demons. And them demons are waiting for opportunities to come in. You're angry, they come in. You cheating. You think about cheating. You think about doing something outside of your marriage. And the devil's sitting there waiting to come in. Because he don't just want you to flirt. You just want him to flirt. You just went to work to flap your eyelashes. But the devil got another plan. So, she a plan. So they get this cheating demon in her. To make her flirt and go a little further than she anticipated. Then you get connected into something you can't even remember how you got there. Yeah. Happened so fast. It's all a strategy of the devil. Right. To you, it happened real fast. To the devil, it's a part of his plan. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's Brian Hollingsworth. Yeah, I got him right here. We've been following him. We know what he's thinking about because he talks about it. I don't know his thoughts, but I know the conversations he's been having on the phone. So I just send my little cheating demon to sit in the car with him. And as soon as he opens the door a little bit, then I send that demon into his heart. Because as soon as he begins to talk like that, the presence of God is not in his life in that area. And evil exists. And I can come in where evil exists. I can't come in where the presence of God is, but as soon as evil raised her ugly head, I can come right in there. And all I need to do is get one little demon in, one little demon. If I get one little demon in, then he'll invite other ones in.
Amen.
Oh, I've been cheating, I gotta lie. Where you at, honey? Oh, I'm at Lowe's. Now, that little lion demon can come in. Well, I'm over here by Lowe's. I don't see your car. Now I got to get angry. So the anger demon got to come in. I told you I just left Lowe's. I'm telling you, sounds funny, but that's how demons come in.
Yes, it is.
And before you know it, they're saying we are legions, we are many. Because we all up in here now. Cheating, lying, anger, cunning, deceit, all them demons have one function. They're not multifunctional. They have one function. A lying demon can't make you cheat. So that means if you lie and cheat, that means you got two demons. And they're not multifunctional. They have one function. So you think about all the things you're doing, it may cause you to lift your hands. Say, Lord, deliver me. That's what I say, in the evil day. And having done all to stand, putting on the whole armor of God causes you to stand. In the evil day, in the day of attack, it causes you to stand. It says stand therefore having your loins girt about with the truth, having the word of God in your head. It can't just be on the page as child of God. It's got to be, that word has got to be in your mouth. The word in this Bible, it's got to be in your mouth. It's got to be in your mouth. You got to speak it from your mouth. You got to speak it boldly from your mouth. It says, stand therefore having your loins girt about with the truth and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Amen. I'm righteous. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You got to put it on every single day. Every single day you got to put it on. And I'm telling you, what hinders us from putting it on is our lifestyle. If you are not living a holy life, you will not put the armor on. If you're not living a holy life, you will not pray for your children. You will not pray for your marriage. You will not pray for anybody else, because that life that you're living is going to constantly hinder you and keep you from being all that God wants you to be. And the devil is like, well, we ain't got to worry about him. We ain't got to worry about O'Brien, because he's saved, but he ain't living nothing. So don't go over there. We already got him. He already, you know, the hypocrite that we want him to be. It's so much he can't do everything that God wants him to do because of his life. Some of us are like that. I want to do it, but I got all this stuff. Let it go. Let it go.
Yes, Lord.
Turn away from it.
That's right.
Amen.
Because all you're doing is being pimped by the devil.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, who want to be pimped by anybody?
No.
Especially the devil.
Right.
That's what's happening, man. You're being pimped. He's pimping you. He's benefiting off of what you're doing. So then your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. We got to take the gospel out. We got to carry the gospel.
Amen.
We got to be God's helpers. Got to be God's helpers. When you leave church, your Bible closed, you never say another word about Jesus till you come back to church midweek or Sunday. Shame, shame, shame. That's not a disciple. That's not a bold believer. Well, Pastor, I pray for people at home. No, we're not talking about that. We're talking about when you go to store, when you go to work, when you go bold. When you bold, God will create opportunities. When you bold, opportunities will come. You don't have to say, I don't have anybody to talk to. Well, it's only because you're not bold. God said, why would I send anybody your way? Because I know you're not going to say anything about me. Somebody come to you and start talking to you about the trouble. You're listening, but in your mind, you think about your trouble. And you can't wait till they finish until you say, "Well, let me tell you what I'm going through." We were supposed to carry the gospel out. And it says, and above all, taking the shield of faith. Say shield of faith. Wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts. The darts are fiery, but the shield of faith is the rivers of living water that quenches and puts out those fiery darts. Those darts that's coming from everywhere. A shield, you have to be in a position to move a shield, you know, because you don't know where they're coming from. The shield, amen, is movable. You're able to move it because darts are coming. Fiery darts are coming from the devil. They may come through your friends, your family, your co-workers, people you don't know, but they're coming. And the shield of faith is I got faith in God. My faith in God that gives me the ability to stand. There's no rear guard. Because God never expects us to turn and run. He expects us to stand. To stand. And to be able to stand with everything that we've got on. We put on the whole armor of God. We got the truth. We know that we're the righteousness of God. We got our feet protected because we're taking the gospel out. We got the shield of faith. Amen. Wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts. And take the helmet of salvation. Amen. Of the mind of Christ. Amen. Christ's mind. The wisdom of God. The wisdom of God. The plan of God. The helmet of salvation. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. The word of God. That's why in church, in Abounding Grace, we teach you. We prepare you. We give you the right information so that you can walk out of here and be a disciple for God. Amen. Amen. We don't program you to death. We don't give you nonsense. We give you what you need to go out and deal with spiritual warfare. What you need to go out and not only be a blessing to somebody else, but to be a blessing for your own family. Amen. 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 Praise God. That's what we get. The songs we try to sing here are songs that we try to do vertical songs where it's going straight to God. We're talking about God. We worshiping and praising God because God, he's the one we're worshiping and praising. And so we don't sing a whole lot of stuff that would get us into, you know, our flesh and into our own emotions. We're praising God so that his presence will fill this room and he will soften our hearts so that we can hear his word. Amen. And then we walk out of here and we leave out of here after receiving communion. Remembering Jesus Christ and going forth out there to serve. Amen. To be the helpers of God. Bringing in the lost. Bringing in those who are sick. Laying hands on the sick. We all know in this church that we have the power and the authority to lay hands on sick people. Amen. Nobody's got to bring anybody, Pastor Hollins or Pastor Corey, anybody here. You know you got the power in the name of Jesus to lay hands on sick people and they shall recover. You got to believe that. You have got to believe it. You've got to believe it. Because the word of God says it. Amen. God's word says it. So if God's word says it, it is true. If God's word says it, I believe it. Amen. Amen. I'm not coming to church to be convinced. I'm already convinced. Amen. 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 It says, take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying. Say always.
Always.
With all prayer. In supplication in the Spirit and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. That's what we do. Praying, praying, praying. What's going to save Shreveport? Praying. Amen. Praying. Praying. That's what's going to save Shreveport. That's what's going to turn Shreveport around. How many murders were there? Last night, anybody know? Anybody get killed last night? Here? No. What about Friday night? Anybody get killed Friday night?
Thursday, Friday, no.
Amen. When, Mr. Brandon? anybody here thirsty? Okay. Okay. Well, I tell you, I'm praying here Thursday night. We don't know how many people would have died. Had we not prayed. We don't know what the total would have been. Amen. But we're praying for the killer to stop. And we can't just pray for the killer to stop. We got to go out. I've been asking the Holy Spirit, Lord, show me what to do. Show me what to do next that will impact our city, impact our lost. We've got to impact the lost. Yeah. We've got to impact those who the devil is attacking. Amen. I'm telling you something. The devil afraid of us. He afraid of this church right here. You, no need for you to be afraid of him. He's afraid of us. He's betting that you're going to be afraid of him. But he is afraid of us because we got his playbook. We know the next play he's going to run. Amen. And we don't have to be there because we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We pray. It says praying always. That's what we got to do. Praying always. Sometimes turn the TV off. Hear my voice. In the name of Jesus, Lord, let them hear my voice. Turn them phones off. Shut that Facebook down. Pray. It takes you praying to establish a habit of praying. It takes you praying. Come out to prayer, 11:45 to 12:45, Monday and Friday. 6 o'clock on Mondays as well. We praying here. Amen. I'm telling you, we're praying. We've been doing it all year. Come out and pray. We praying not just for abounding grace, but we praying for our nation, our president, our governor, our mayor's office, people in authority, amen. We're praying for the lost. We're praying. In that hour, we get a lot of prayer. We get a lot of stuff prayed for. Amen. And it's praying for 1 hour. Praise God. It says, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth. So put on the whole armor of God. So put on every part of the armor that you need. And he said, and as for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth, say boldly, to make known the mystery of the gospel. See, we got to open our mouth. We got to open our mouth boldly. God is looking for bold Christians, bold helpers that will go out, win souls, hallelujah, bring in the lost, lay hands on the sick. God is looking for, all he wants us to do is to just be led by his Spirit. And I tell you what, when you make your mind up that you're going to be led by the Spirit of God, God will create the occasions where you need to do whatever it is you need to do. Amen. He'll do it. All he's looking for is somebody who's with him. Somebody who's with him. Somebody who's not bogged down with their bills, bogged down with the cares of life. I tell you what, it's when you turn your attention to the Lord that the Lord turns his attention to your stuff. Amen. When you turn your face to God, when you turn your attention to the things of God, then God begins to look at your stuff. I'm telling you, it works. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. I tell you, God said, you don't have to worry about your stuff. You're taking care of my stuff. I'm going to take care of yours. But the devil want to make you believe that if you don't do it right now, it's not going to happen. Worry about it, and it never get accomplished. So you're so busy worried about the cares of life that over here, the assignment that God has purpose you, has positioned you for, can never get accomplished because your hands are so filled with the cares of life. And Jesus said to us, in this life, there'll be tribulations. He said, but be of good cheer, I will overcome. You're an overcomer. Amen. From the day till the day you die, you're going to have stuff handed to you. Amen. Amen. That woman that came to see me Wednesday, she said, my house is paid for, my cars are paid for. I'm not in any debt, I don't have anything. But look what the devil handed her. She wasn't worried about paying her bills. She wasn't worried about finances at all. But just because she had all her stuff paid for, didn't immune her from being attacked by the devil. The devil will always come. He's coming. He's coming after your body. He's coming after your children. Amen. Praise God. He's coming. He's coming. Are you ready? Got to be ready. Come on, stand with me. Got to be ready. Uncommon Church is abounding grace with a holistic ministry. Words out of Marty Alexander's mouth. Uncommon Church is what we want to be. An uncommon group of people with a holistic ministry. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. People who will open their mouth, be bold for the Lord. Something about this is of trouble. When you just make up your mind, I don't care what I'm going through, I'm going to praise the Lord. We're going to worship God no matter what. What's going on? We're going to worship God in my house. And praise God in our house. May not have a nickel in the bank. That doesn't stop me from praising God. Because he's still been providing for me. Two of my firefighter buddies there. And one of them walked out of the door, walked out from behind the room, had his appointment, he came out. I said, hey man, haven't seen him in a few years. I said, hey. He said, he just told me I got cancer. I said, well, we're going to pray for your deliverance. Let me tell you something. You can think your day bad. And somebody can walk up to you and say something like that. He said, well, they just told me to sit here and wait. And they're going to tell me what they plan to do about it. Hadn't told his wife, hadn't told his son that. Because he just got information. But God knew that I was going to be sitting right there. And God knew that I would pray for him. See, God will position you. When he know that you will be used by him and you won't be so wrapped up in your stuff, wrapped up in what you're going through, me and my wife are sitting there. That's what God looking for. People that will say, here I am, Lord. Here I am. Here I am. Send me, Lord. Here I am. Use me, Lord. Here I am. Make me bold, dear God. You want boldness? Come to the altar. Just stand here. Just stand at the altar. We're going to pray. You want that boldness? You know that. Boldness on your job, boldness at home. God, I want this boldness, Lord. I want this boldness. Hallelujah. Parents, it keeps dropping in my spirit. Parents, you gotta be bold. Because you gotta teach them babies to be bold. And devil's after babies today like never before. I tell you, the devil is after children. He is after children. Because he don't want them to come up and cause him any problems. He know that they can. Because they're innocent. If they are taught the right way, they'll believe what they're taught. Because they don't know anything. They don't know anything but to believe what mama and daddy said. Come on, lift your hands up to the Lord. Close your eyes, amen. Don't play with God. Just listen. The first thing you have to be bold to do is bold to live a holy life. You can't live for the world and live for the Lord. You'll never be effective for God. You'll be effective only for the world. You bring shame on the kingdom of God. You bring shame on the kingdom of God if you live unholy and unrighteous. It's just the bottom line. If you live in that way, you're bringing shame to God's kingdom. And it's keeping somebody from seeing God. The first thing you got to do is say, Lord, I don't want to bring any shame. I don't want to bring any shame to the kingdom. If I don't want to bring any displease you in any way, Lord. If my life is not right, say, Lord, help me to live a holy life. Help me to pull away from the things that I'm doing that's bringing shame to the body where the temple of God dwells. And help me, dear God, to have a mind and a heart to desire more than anything to live a holy life, a set apart life. God, help me to want that life. God, I want that life. Tell the Lord, say, I want that life. I want that bold life, God. I want that life that pleases you. I want that life that glorifies you. I want that life, God, that you can use, that life that's led by your Spirit, oh God. That's the life I want, God. I don't want this life that I've been living, this way that I've been thinking, God. I don't want this slowful, lazy life that I've got. God, I want a life that would be pleasing to you. And maybe some of you say, Pastor, I live a holy life, but I'm just lazy. I'm just slowful. I just make excuses for everything. And I just want to stop making excuses. And I want to open my mouth. I'm not going to say I don't talk a lot and I don't know what to say. But I know that if I open my mouth, that God will speak through me and that he will give me what to say. And I'll always be prepared because I'll gird my loins with the truth. And the truth is the word of God. And I'll stand. I'm able to stand with the arm of God. I'm able to stand in every evil day. I'm able to stand without falling. I will not fall. I will not go down. I'm able to stand because I've got the word of God in my heart. The blessed weight of righteousness upon my chest. I've got the shield of faith and the helmet of salvation. And my feet are covered in preparation of the gospel that I can go forward and carry the gospel. I have the word of God. I know the devil's after my family. I know he's after my children, our children. But God, we pray, thanking you, God, for victory on today. In the name of Jesus, that we will be bold, cause our mouths to be called, come bold, dear God. That we will boldly proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ everywhere we go, God. God, create that. God, we know that when our hearts are hungry to be bold, that you will create opportunities, God, that we can speak. And that we can tell people about Jesus. That we can say Jesus Christ is the Lord. And there's no other way to him, to God, except through Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ is a healer. That he is a deliverer in the name of Jesus. That we will tell people that Jesus can help you. Jesus can make your life better. Jesus can bring you out. Let Jesus do it. And God, let us say it with conviction and say it boldly, dear God, because we ourselves believe it. We know it to be true. In the name of Jesus. So Lord, bless those who are standing at this altar. God, change their hearts. Change their minds. Change our ways, oh God. That every part of us line up with your promise and your will for our life, dear God. God, anoint us with the Holy Spirit, oh God. Lead us, oh God. Let us follow you, Holy Ghost. You know the way. We don't know the way. But we will follow you and we will be led by you. In the name of Jesus. God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, God, that we will begin today to remove those things that hinder our walk with you, that hinder our prayers, that keeps us in bondage. Those things that we thought we couldn't get rid of, God, we will loose those things today in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we can lift our hands and praise you. Thank you, Lord, that we can call on your name. Thank you for blessing our children, God. Bless these children, God. Bless these babies, God. These little ones, dear God, that are built for being delivered for warfare, God. Oh, God, we need to train them. We need to train them up, oh God. We need to train them to fight. Train them to put on the armor of God. Train them to pray, God. Train them to lay hands, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. 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 What you gonna do next? What you gonna do next? What's gonna happen next in your life? What is going to happen after today in your life or during the day in your life? Hallelujah. Serve the Lord. Listen, if you're sick in your body, you come today because you're sick in your body. You say, Pastor, I'm sick. Got sickness in my body, and I don't want to be healed on today. I'm inviting you to come now. You're sick in your body. And you desire to be healed on today. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Sick in your body. You desire to be healed on today. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Glory. Oh, Lord, hallelujah. Amen. Or maybe you're here today and you say, I have a relationship with Jesus, but I don't have a place of worship. And I believe the Holy Spirit is leading me to be here to worship with abounding grace. I want to be here to grow, and I want to be here to serve. Amen. And if that's you, and this is where the Holy Spirit is leading you to come, leading you to be, I'm inviting you to come right now. Come right now. You be at home. Amen. Come join us. Amen. Amen. Be a part of what God's doing here at the house of grace. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord. Well, let's prepare our hearts for the ministry of giving. Thank you, thank you, Jesus. Sing me. Well, I want you to remain standing. Amen. Are there any announcements? Amen. Praise God. Amen. Brother God, will you come and dismiss us?
Father God, let the grace in your sweet communion rest and abide in all of us, Lord God. Keep us and keep us safe, Lord God. I ask that you give us traveling grace from the time we leave here, Lord God, till we get to our destination. Let us always remember your word and your teaching. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Let us all say amen.
Amen.